Oh, sorry. preachers in the book of Revelation chapter 4, he said they were doing something. They weren't just sitting there. He said they were going around that throne, rallying about it, and they were singing one to the other, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." Amen. Which was and is to come. And they said in the end of their song, said they were giving glory because he was worthy to receive glory and honor and power. And he said, "All thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are what? Created." Amen. And when you get the understanding that your very existence brings pleasure to your Heavenly Father, you'll pray different. You'll go to church different. You'll live this life twice as different as you used to. When you get in on the fact that God's got pleasure, when I have pleasure. When God's happy, I'm happy. When Jesus, oh glory, he gets happy when I get happy. He sings when I sing. He worships when I worship. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. He whatever makes me happy in him makes him happy. There you go. Glory. Whatever gives me rest makes me get in a place where I don't war and I don't struggle. That's the contentment of God's heart. Is to have a people in this earth that don't feel like they're going under. You hear me? That's what excites your Father. Is to look and see you, glory to God. Get up every morning and not dread your day. And go to bed every night and not be afraid to go to sleep. To lay there all night long without a toss or a turn and just content. In him. Oh my God. How many of you know that that nighttime war can be the worst war? How many of you understand that there are thoughts that will hit you on your bed at night that won't hit you no other time of the day? That's the reason David said in the Psalms, "The Lord's compassed me about through the night with songs of deliverance." Hallelujah. That's the reason Solomon said there were 60 valiant men that he camped around his bed every night. Glory to God. They all had swords upon their thighs. They were guarding and protecting the man of God as he lay and slept. Protecting him from what? Thoughts, bad dreams, wicked fears. There's things that will try to choke you at night. You know, if you have, this is the truth in the word, if you have any kind of digestive problem, that's when it gets worse in the night. If you praise the Lord. And my granddad one time got plagued with a choking thing that would come on him. And it'd try to kill him in the night time. And he would sit up or he'd wake up and he'd almost be gone. Amen. And he'd poke my nan and she'd jump up and hit him on the back with her hands and say, "In Jesus' name, come out of him." Hallelujah. And he'd get all right. Only one night he woke up and it was too late. He tried to sit up, but he was already going out. And he said as he fell over on that bed, somehow or another, his hand managed to poke her and fall on her and wake her up. And she jumped up that time. She really had to believe to get the victory and got him back too. Hallelujah. And suddenly, he got up, walked down the hallway one day, and he said, "I'm going to tell you right now, you can't kill me." He said, "I'm going to live." And the Lord spoke to him instantly and said, "The length of thy days I will fulfill." That's the reason I could pass by the coffin with confidence and go commit him to that ground without having a nervous bone in my body, because the Lord Jesus told him, "The length of the number of thy days I will fulfill." And God don't lie. Amen. And so anyway, he got to praying over and he told the Lord. Finally, he quit going to bed and just sat in a chair sleeping. And so you may like it or not, like it's really irrelevant for this story, because it did happen. That Brother Angel come to tap him and Tampa Lake from Tampa, probably. And he'd come out on that platform, and my granddad, he didn't fall. Now, he could pray for 100 people and they'd fall, but you really had to have power to push him down, you know. He just didn't go under the Spirit very often, you know. And Brother Ainsley come out with all them thousands of people there and pointed right over there where he was sitting and said, right, John, there's a man been sitting up in a chair all night. Can't sleep because he's got something here in his chest is choking him. Amen. And Mother made him go. She said, that's you, Daddy. You go down there. And he got up, and the brother never even prayed or touched him. He just fell over under the power. And he never, glory to God, never did he have it. And you know what? Later on in life, he had a couple of spells choking, but he didn't have no fear of dying because he knew the Lord healed him for choking. But he scared us to death, but it wouldn't bother him. And two different occasions, one time I wasn't with him, Mother and Dad, and they were in a restaurant. And I'm going to tell you what, they all thought he was gone. But he never thought he was gone because he knew that the Lord had healed him. And he got all right. And then one day I was over in the house and came in, and he got choked so bad, and they were on the phone with the 911. And he couldn't even talk, he was so choked. But he was doing his hands like that and from calling the rescue people. Amen. And everybody tried everything, and it weren't working. A piece of beef got in his windpipe and choked him. Praise God, I climbed up there behind him and grabbed a hold of him, picked him right up off the floor. I said, God, move this thing. And I want you to know his breath came back up, praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. But he didn't want, so when soon as he got enough breath to talk, he said, I told you I'd be all right. Hang that phone up. Amen. You know, oh, glory to God. It makes God happy when I don't worry, when I don't fear, when I don't dread. And these things will come on you in the night. You know, if you're going to be afraid, it'll be in the nighttime. If you don't panic, it'll be in the nighttime. One reason is because you can't see things as clearly. And you can't discern things as clearly. And things that are not real get to looking real. And things that can't bother you look like they're going to bother you. And it's a deception that comes on your mind and tries to rob you of the victory. Hallelujah. But David said, even in the night, the Lord got into my room and began to sing over me with songs of deliverance. Hallelujah. And so I want you to know the Lord can turn your whole night upside down and make you dream spiritual dreams, and supernatural events can happen to you while you sleep just like they can while you're awake. Amen. But that's what those preachers were singing, wasn't it? You've created all things, and for thy pleasure they are created. Hallelujah. Well, I got a little lot of pleasure around here yesterday. These kids everywhere. Oh my God, I'm telling you, I don't know how anything we could have got anybody else in that room back there. We all had to stay in one spot because of the rain, and we had the prettiest indoor egg hunt you ever did see, bless God. I'm telling you, just as we had 313 eggs. Hallelujah. And about 30 kids. And upteen big kids, parents. And just as we started out the, or got everybody rounded up to start the party, the bottom fell out. And everything we had planned for was in the out of doors. Amen. So we had to shift the plans. We hid eggs in window sills, under pipes, in corners, in fences, in songbooks, anywhere we could hide an egg, we hid an egg. And bless God, I want you to know, and you wouldn't even know they knew it changed, the plan had changed. They just went running out of there and had themselves a ball. I want you to know they had a wonderful time, and it was just awesome. It was a beautiful day. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Just a great day. Now, on April the 2nd, which will be a Saturday, we're going to have a church work day in the yards and here in the sanctuary, and just getting spring cleaned done and limbs trimmed and fresh mulch and things of that nature out. And then on April the 3rd, that following Sunday evening service at 6 o'clock, Brother Ken Hill will be ministering. He's the pastor that visited here the other Sunday night from Fort Myers. He's a wonderful preacher. Oh, he's got a good word. He's really got a heavy anointing to preach, and his testimony was enough to go home on. Amen. So he's coming back. He'd be at Sunshine the morning service, then come over here and be with us in that evening service. Now, today's offering, aside from the tithes and things designated to go to specific places, we are taking a missions offering. Our last missions offering we took when Brother Mogi was home and gave that to their work. And to this time, the Philippine missionary is where we're focusing on, because they're getting ready the second week of April. They'll have their annual ministers convention. And so they need us to help with getting all the food for that and bussing all the pastors in from the church. We've got 12 churches around the, oh Lord, there in the lowlands, in the mountain lands, and everything has to come to Baguio to check in once a year at least. Amen. And it's not fair if the little pastors can't come because of lack of finance. So they bus every one of them, their wives, and so forth, in for that convention. So they have to bed them all, which is no problem with them. They don't need but a little space, and they're just happy to be there. But anyway, usually they purchase about 3 or 4 whole hogs to barbecue for that whole convention. It'll last them the whole meeting, so we want to help with that. It'll take $1,700 to cover the whole cost. And Brother Julian's church, of course, will send some. And then I did get a report, fresh report, that Brother Gomez turned the fully retired and turned the work over to his son, Stephen. He's now president over the work, and that's a good thing. Brother Gomez is probably in his 80s now. I'd say at least 81, somewhere in there. And he wants to just kind of delegate and sit back. And Brother Julian sent me a message and said that he wants to go to the Philippines before he got where he totally disliked traveling. And he asked if I'd be the one to go down with him. So we're praying about God to show us a time of the year to go. So you believe God with us to lead us. But anyway, we want to bless them. We want them preachers all there for that meeting. Amen. And if they're opening up and having it, God's surely going to open up the heavens and bless it and give them an anointing to teach them what they need to know. And they have awesome meetings. They're worshipers. I'm going to tell you, they dance some time of hour when they go to church. And that's the truth. So we want to just make a way for that to happen. Amen. And if we get over, you know what we're going to do? We're going to give it over. Because I'll just let them add a few things they wasn't planning on adding. Amen. So get your offerings, your tithes, your gifts ready to give to the Lord this morning. Amen. Thank you for indulging me through all them announcements. I never make them, and then I forget them.
Wait a minute.
And then I get told later, well, you forgot this, and I said, I did indeed. So I tried to make a point this morning to say, Matt Clark, make the announcements. Hallelujah. So I have made them. Amen. And I bless you. Bring your gifts to the Lord in Jesus' name. greet us this morning. Give us a good, well, I'll bring you the mic so everybody will hear. Amen. There you
I
go.
Just wanted to give a testimony of what God did between last Sunday and this week in my body. I had to get blood work done, and I had to get complete blood work done this time. And, you know, everything had to get checked. And I just praise God that I got the best report that I have gotten in well over a year. My hemoglobin had come up to 12.7. And my cholesterol had gone down. I know I don't look like I have a cholesterol problem, but it's some hereditary thing that I'm telling it's going to leave my body. But it had gone down several points. My platelets came up. My red blood cells, everything. My doctor told me, he said, you know, this is the best report you've had in a long time. And you know, you said to believe God that everything was going to level out. And I spoke that all week. You know, I had to go to the doctor Thursday. And I just kept telling my body, everything in you is going to level out to where it's supposed to be. And so, again, you know, I thank God that prophecy works. You know, we need, and I've said this before, but when somebody gives a prophetic word, you need to take it to heart and claim it. And I was even, that message you preached last Sunday, and I won't leave it a minute, I was outside working in the yards this week, and I was pulling weeds and, you know, doing stuff, and I was just telling my plants that they were going to disassociate themselves from the weeds, and the weeds were cursed, and I just spoke, you know, God said, and for thy pleasure they are created, and I spoke to the plants what the message was last week. And I told them they were going to magnify the Lord, and they were going to come forth with a lot of blooms and a lot of roses and a lot of poinsettias, and they were just going to bless God because they were part of His creation.
Amen.
You know, Jeremiah said, "Oh earth, 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 bless you the Lord. Hear the word of the Lord, O earth." And sometimes I tell this earthen vessel that we are, Paul says. We have this treasure in earthen vessels. And I believe part of that treasure is prophecy and calling it forth. And this earthen vessel, I prophesy too. I prophesy my own prophecies to myself. But I just thank God that God really touched my body. I mean, He really did. And I've got more energy than I've had in a long time. And I just thank God, Brother Matt, I just thank God that God's word works. It works. The messages we hear, we just need to apply them to every part of our life. And I'm just believing God that everything else is going to come in line. And I'm going to see the prosperity I want to see. Because it's part of the prophecy and it's coming forth. So I just praise God today that prophecy came forth.
Yes, amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Amen. Boy, I could tell when she, I was going around the back this morning when she was getting out of the car, and I said, "Oh, Sister Shirley has got a different look this morning. She must be feeling better." Hallelujah. Amen. Now, the Bible says that in the Garden of Eden, it never rained. Never rained. Just the glory come up out of the earth like a mist. Why did it never rain? Because all of heaven was operating already in that garden. There was no need in that garden. See, the earth has need to drink of the rain, but the garden didn't need anything to fall in it because it was already planted with the goodness of God. And the fullness was in manifestation. and there was no need to look outside of its realm for anything else because it was a realm of divine perfection. No ravenous beast gnashed his teeth. No poison of the asp went into a human being. In fact, everything including the body itself was fully under the dominion of the created order of God. It's the order of life. And let me tell you something, God's order of life and God's law of supply is an extravagant law. If you don't think it is, just check out it right down to the littlest bug it lands on you. And find out he took time to paint even them little dips in their wings that you don't have the time to notice about. Yet the intelligence of the Father. Oh, praise the Lord. Not in procreation. Now that beauty wasn't released in procreation. It was released through creation. See, procreation is a release of what the one that you know, the one that handles the life, he releases that. In other words, I've got the blood and physique and features of ancestors before me because I'm a product in the natural of a procreation, but not so in the spirit. My spirit is not procreated. My spirit is created in the image and in the likeness of God. Praise the Lord. I'll get to my scripture in a minute. But you and I are not products of somebody who fought in an earthly realm how to bring us forth. But before the world was, I was a word in God before the world was. Before I ever took on this earthly mind. And before I ever took on this skin, and before I ever took on the seed of my earthly father, I was begotten of the Word, and I was born of the Spirit. Ephesians, the first chapter, said, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual." Ooh, can you grab a hold of that this morning? Not earthly blessing, not natural blessing, not things he came out of the earthen realm, but all spiritual blessings. Then he told us where he blessed. Everybody say, that's what he blessed. Now, where did he bless? In heavenly places, in Christ Jesus. Glory be to God. According as he hath chosen us in him. Chosen simply means be called by name. Amen. In him before the foundation of the world. Now, I don't have time to teach a Bible study in Sunday morning worship service, but if you do your own study, you'd find out quickly that before the foundation of the world means what you were before the fall. Amen. So listen, if everything was in that life, and it was. Now we'll watch it when Jesus came forth. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was, and the Word was God. Not just is, was. Amen. Colossians says it this way, and he is before all things, and all things are made by him. And without him was not anything made that was made, for by him all things consist. Hallelujah. Woo. Hebrews 11:3 says it this way, through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which appear, or things which are seen, was not made of things which do appear. Oh, glory. And then the Lord turned around and put us in the picture. Because God can't talk about himself without talking about his creation, because he sees his creation as part of it. He don't see it as just something he made to help earth out a little bit and then send it off. No, he's very involved with his creation. He's in the midst. I'll tell you now, John seen him, didn't he? He weren't walking away over yonder on the mountaintop. He was walking in the midst of the candlesticks. What's the candlestick? The church. Where is Jesus at? The Lamb at? He's in the midst. He's right here in the midst of this worship going on this morning. Amen. So he includes us. Well, glory. Jesus included me. Yes, he included me. When the Lord said, whosoever, he included me. Jesus included me. Yes, he included me. When the Lord said, whosoever, he included me. Hallelujah. 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 Yes, indeed. He made a point to reference man out. He said that same word was in the beginning with God, didn't he? He said, in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. Then he brought in that other and said, the same was in the beginning with God. The same what? The same word. And when you're in your earthen suit right here, going through your daily business, accomplishing what you have to accomplish, it isn't a different word. It isn't another anointing. It isn't a different source. It's the same word that was in the beginning with God that is at work within you right now. What same word? The same word that created the oceans. The same word that cut out the valleys. The same word that flung stars. Flung them from his fingers. Oh, hallelujah. The same was in the beginning. So where was I? In the beginning. Well, glory. Now you do understand that total redemption means God's trying to get your consciousness to go back to what you knew before you ever fell into this corruption by way of an earthen birth. Because Paul says it this way, I'm carnal, sold under sin. David said, in sin and iniquity did my mother and father conceive me. He's talking about your mom and daddy in the house over yonder. He's talking about the mother and father of all living, which is Adam and Eve. Everybody has to come by way of Adam to get into this earth. But I want you to know, before you get in that Adam that fell, you're in another Adam. And Paul talked about him in 1 Corinthians 15. He said the first man is of the earth earthly, but the second man is the Lord from heaven. Hallelujah. And then he said, as we have borne the image of the earth, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. Amen. The first man, Adam, was made a living soul. But he didn't say the second Adam. He said the last Adam. Because he seals up the Son. Hallelujah. He's the totality of redemption. There'll never be another bull, another lamb, another goat, another dove. But he offered himself once and for all. He has perfected forever them that are sanctified by one offering of redemption. Well, glory. Well, I better forget them scriptures for a minute, because I can't run two trains. You got to understand something. This stuff is identity. It's who you are. It's what gives you the ability, the right, the stamina, the force to stand in the throne this morning and declare, I have rights. I have access. Amen. Well, glory to God. You know, and I was teaching you here the other night on Sunday night, not too long ago, how that the 7 days of earthly creation are a picture of a sevenfold work that God done in man to redeem him from corruption. And how that in our fallen nature, we were, that darkness was on our deep, and we were void and we were empty. And the Spirit of God rose up within us by regeneration of a new birth. Glory. Nicodemus said, I know you're from God. Snuck out there at night, didn't he? He didn't want other preachers to see him. He said, I know you're of God. Because no man can work these miracles except God be with him. But he said, what I want to know is, oh glory. And it's the same thing I want to know. How do I get that life? Hebrew Shatamah, that works in you to work in me. Oh yes. John 6, the disciples said the same thing. Master, what must we do that we may work the works of God? Jesus said, ain't one thing you can do. Believe on him whom the Father has sent. In other words, it ain't a matter of you crossing off enough things on your list. You better let the list go. Well, okay, God don't give a flu-hooey about your list or how many steps you got. You run a service on the list and the Holy Ghost will tie that thing right down the middle and take over in a minute's time. Amen. So that isn't the answer. And you going through a seven-course program ain't the answer. Self-help's not the answer. No. All that does is tell alcoholics they have to be one till they die. That's why they never get delivered. Because every week they get up and publicly confess, I am what I am. They got this, I shouldn't even say this publicly, they got this whatever addiction thing that everybody posts on Facebook. I would just take a shotgun and blow every one of them signs a piece. To pieces. I've never heard such foul unbelief and such demeaning of human beings in my born day. You might as well tie a chain and ball around your foot and go the rest of your life that way, because that is the mentality they tell you every day you're going to fight it. Every day you got, I want you to know that just ain't so, my brother and sister. There's an identity in Christ, and if you become one with, you'll take on His man and do the works that He did and greater works than these shall ye do. And you being told every week that you are a prisoner to this, you will have to learn to live with it. You might as well hang a sign over your door that says alcoholism runs this house. Dope runs this house. But brother Jesus, when He got to the madman of Gadara, He didn't come over there and shake His hand and say, I'll build a strong enough chain you can't break it, and these men will water you and feed you when you need it. No, He said He was found sitting in His right mind and called, hallelujah. He wasn't insane no more. He wasn't tormented no more. Glory. Man's torment, that darkness is on the abyss. That water in their soul is troubled. There's a stirring in them. Night and day they hear it roaming and roaring out. And everybody tells them, hang on, it'll be all right. What they need is somebody to tell them, that's God in you trying to wake you up and show you you've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Not offer them a council session where all you do is find out what their mama done and their daddy done. My brother, bless his heart, was through a judge, was made susceptible by demand to such courses. And at the end of their course, everybody had to get up and write their plot, their plight in life, you know. And so this one said, you know, my dad was an alcoholic. Mother was a gambler. This, that, and the other. They all got through. Chris got up to say his. He said, I don't know what they're talking about. He said, my folks were Christians, church-going Pentecostals. They believed in deliverance. He said, I ain't here because a bunch of people stuck me to it. He said, I'm here because I made wrong decisions. I'm here because I followed the wrong crowd. Oh, he made his overseer quite angry. But he said, all this y'all are talking about, you just pushing it off on everybody else because you don't want to admit that God needs to do something in you. He said, well, I know God needs to do something in me. Praise the Lord. He come out of that one. Bless his heart, he come out of that one, and he decided he could take Sunday mornings around here. And he took Sunday mornings. Then it is, I'm different to what these other preachers are. I think the more you're used, the more you'll hang in there. So I went home and told him, I said, it's stupid for you to sit on that pew and them drums empty, and I need a drummer. Get on them drums and play. So he started getting on there and playing. Well, on Sunday nights, he started joining us till the prayer line started, and then he'd leave out the side door. Then he got coming on Wednesdays. Oh, glory. Then one night back then, my chairs were to the side and the drums were right behind me. Then one night, we was all worshiping God. I heard somebody behind me just a-talking in tongues. Praise God, I thought, who in the world's talking in tongues? I turned around and looked behind me, and he had both hands up just to talking in tongues. Well, I never asked him what day or nothing. I just said, well, praise God, he must got woke up all the way. Hallelujah. And that's what it is. It's a waking up. It's a quickening. Hallelujah. It's the resurrection of the Holy Ghost within you. That's all Nicodemus wanted to know. How do I have what you have? How can I do what you do? There ain't but one pattern, son, folks. And that's Jesus. Amen. Now, how do I do it? And Jesus said clearly to him, if a man ain't born again, he can't inherit eternal life. If he ain't born of water, he can't see the kingdom. And if he ain't born of spirit, he can't enter the kingdom. Nicodemus said, oh God, let me see here. He said, you mean tell me, how is this possible? Can I re-enter my mother's womb the second time and be born again? And Jesus said, I ain't talking about earthly things. I'm talking about heavenly things. Then he said, how can you be a master in Israel and not know these things I'm talking to you about? He said, that which is flesh is flesh, and that which is spirit is spirit. He said, the wind blows out here wherever it listed, and no man knows where it goes or from whence it came. And he said, furthermore, you can't grab a hold of my wind and put it in a little box and contain it. He said, so goes the spirit of man. Your spirit was born to soar. Your spirit was born to fly. Your spirit was born to escape the chains of corruption and to come forth in power and in demonstration of the glory of God. Well, glory. I don't know about you, that preached me happy. I'm telling you, there's a stirring going on in the body of Christ. Now, if you want your identity back, you got to know how you lost it. You got to know what the fall is. What is the fall? And where did it fall? Where did he fall from? Well, he fell in identity. He fell right here. He let the voice of reasoning convince him that he wasn't who God said he was. The other secret to it, of course, I won't go into that in detail, is knowing that Genesis 1 creation and Genesis 2 creation of the man is two separate accounts of work of God in man. Number one is a spirit. The first is always a spirit. That first man he did not form, he created. And that's a spirit man. But he had to form a body for that spirit to get into. You say that and some preachers immediately make a note of the day not to never have you again. But all that is you taking what the preacher says for granted instead of reading the Bible for yourself. You read the Bible for yourself, you better believe there are two accounts. Genesis 1:26 is not a body creation. It's a spirit creation. The Lord God created man in his own image. He said, let us make man in our own image, in our own likeness. And in the likeness and image of God created he them. Watch that now. Yet there wasn't but one name, and that was Adam. And I'm preaching better than you're shouting now. That's more than spirit, that's spirit and soul. Can you say amen? The spirit in the original text, the spirit is the male. The soul is a female. That's the reason you read all them scriptures in the Bible about men having power over women, the head over every woman. You need to know what that means in the spirit. That means your spirit dominates your life and not your emotional realm. Amen. And women ought to keep silent in the church. Your soul ought not to get out of control and express itself through emotions that are wild and untamed. It ought to be the spirit doing the expression in them. Makes more sense, don't it? I'm afraid if a woman didn't speak in some churches, you'd never hear nothing worth hearing. Because some of them men just parroting the same old thing they've said for 40 years. Them women already know they're going to have a struggle to get ahead, so they just fight on through and get a revelation from God. Amen. If it hadn't been for a woman, they wouldn't even be missionaries. The women went and done what the men was too lazy to do, and the men still got all the credit for it. Amen. You know it's so. There ain't but one. And besides that, I told you last Sunday, anytime, whether it be male or female, anybody brings the word of God to you, that is a man of God speaking to you. Can you say praise the Lord? But anyway, you got to know these things. I mean, I'm going to go on and teach. Let me tell you what's happened here. 2 weeks ago on Thursday night, God birthed a message in this church about enlargement. We were praying, and we got in a great anointing, and the prayer, when you get in a great anointing praying, it turns prophetic, and we started moving into prophecy. And it was all about wealth transfers and greatness taking hold and so forth. And so then Sunday morning, I preached to you on the large anointing. And then Sunday night, the Lord used Janet to come in here and take right up where that ended. And she birthed a whole nother category of that thing out. Wednesday night, oh, the Holy Ghost came in here so strong. And I've taught you on the law of attraction as it concerns goodness, how you attract goodness. Because David said, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Then we went into another realm of it. It won't just follow me, it'll catch up with me. And then it won't just catch up with me, it'll overtake me. Hallelujah. And so I'm just flowing right along with the same vein, really. But before I can say some of these things, I think it needs to be re-testified to our spirits that we must know what power we really have been begotten of. If we're going to see what we long to see, it's not going to come out of a half-faint-hearted, to a double-minded knowledge of who you are. My God, you must hold on to the Word and say, this is who I am. I am not like that stuff out there. I'm not like this stuff in here. I'm not like all this roaring going on around me. Oh, hallelujah. And that's the way it is. The spirit of man, he's like a wind. And Jesus said, so goes the spirit of a man. And you can't hold him. You're not going. He wasn't meant to be bound. Amen. So by knowing these two things in Genesis 1 and 2, you see in the second one, God formed a man out of the dust of the earth. That ain't spirit. That's natural. That's dust. To dust thou art, and to dust thou shalt return. Come on now. Jesus said to that Pharisee nation, that religious spirit, he said, you're like a whitewashed sepulcher. On the outside, but on the inside, you're full of what? Dead men's bones. Amen. But then Daniel prophesies and says that there's some that are not going to stay in the dust. Hallelujah. Yeah. Dust round, yeah. Earth round, carnal man, be carnally minded is death. He said they ain't going to stay in the dust round. Some are going to awake to righteousness and are going to sing in redemption. Oh, Sarakamahaya. Everybody isn't dead that looks dead. Some folks are just sleeping, Jesus said. Lazarus is not dead, he just sleeping. If I call him, he'll wake up. Ooh. And John the 5th chapter said, the hour is coming and now is when all they that are in the grave are going to hear the voice of the Son of Man and are going to do what? Come forth. I'll tell you, there's a million people right now shut up. It's a travesty, brother. They're locked under lock and key. They're chained in their mind. They're no different than that man that dwelt among the tomb. They don't know peace in the morning or in the evening. But God's a raising up a man in this earth that is made up of many elements, and he's going to stand up and declare the true identity of the sons of men, and the chains are going to fall off. Oh, I don't mean to growl at you, but I feel a growling. Hallelujah. Maybe I feel a groaning this morning. Amen. Why do you groan? Why do you sorrow? Why do you cry? Because you know there's a release.
Yes, Jesus.
Hear me, church. Anytime a Holy Ghost believer ever gets to groaning, it ain't for sorrow. It ain't because defeats come on. Woo! And remember that, because some days when it used to hit me, I thought I was coming under depression. My wife and I'd be out, and that old spirit of groaning would take a hold of us. I don't mean I literally screamed out of my flesh, boys. I mean just in here. I got so heavy, and I felt so weird. Anybody been there? Brother Hagin said, like washing your feet with your socks on. It's just something wasn't right. I didn't know if something bad was coming. I didn't know what was happening. I had a feeling. I knew it was from God, but I didn't know what it was. We've looked at one another in restaurants over fine meals, lost our appetite, didn't know what in the world was happening, found a feeling that couldn't describe it. Listen to me, don't ever be deceived. That groaning is not for sorrow. That groaning is not for pain. That groaning is not for defeat. That's you groaning for the prisoner to be released, hallelujah, and come out of the prison cell and be set free, hallelujah. Well, glory. You're groaning because you know you've got the thing in you that's going to open the door and let them out. He said he heard their groaning. He sent and broke that staff of bread. He called for a famine in the land, and he raised up one whose name was Joseph, whose feet they laid in iron until iron came into his soul. Until the word of the Lord came, it tried him. But he broke that famine off of them, set them free from poverty, and brought bread back to the house of Jacob because he groaned for a release. Hallelujah. Amen. So you see, everything in you that cries out for more, now I'm seeing how I'm going to be able to tie these in with what I was planning to say to you. Everything in you that cries out for more, better, greater, wealthier, wholer, more healed, more blessed, that's a God-born Holy Ghost cry out of your spirit. And it's called desire. Hallelujah. And desire is a breeding ground for faith. And what it does is it answers the remedy. It answers and remedies all at the same time. Some call the supply and demand. Glory to God. Faith demands it and the Holy Ghost supplies it. Faith demands it to be done. Desire ignites it. You want it. Oh, glory. I don't know what you want. I'm just talking about what I want then. I like the good things. I like the... Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you right now. I like country meals. Biscuits and gravies. In-cut pork chops with a little fat on them. Hallelujah. Brown gravy, grease gravy, ham gravy, red eye gravy, sausage gravy, even egg gravy is wonderful. Hallelujah. And you had to have some poor ancestry to even know what egg gravy is. And I love it. But I'm going to tell you, there ain't nothing no finer than me knowing I can pull in any restaurant I want. Sit down at that table. And not one thing on that menu giving me a shock. Yes. That's called greatness in God. That's called you not being limited in any area of your thinking. I've lived a great deal of my life trying to mize and squeeze. I didn't have no choice. I had to make it last. They say a missionary in his first year, if a fly lands in the soup, they'll pour the whole soup out and not eat it. But a second year missionary would just spoon the fly out, pray over it, and eat it. But a third year missionary would grab the fly up and say, spit it out in Jesus' name. It seems a great deal of life and family, and especially religious. And everything they teach and do, it is to stifle, bind. I mean, there's people that were lived through the depression and they're alive today that have never been able to shake that depression. They still believe they might starve to death. They hoard food like it's money. Come on now. They vote the way they vote because they're afraid they'll get starved out because they've never been able to shake that mentality of living in a depression. They always live their life believing that it can all run out. Christian songs are written that should have never been published that speak about everything running out. Quotes are put on cards and published all over the world that give chance for tomorrow to not come and for if it does come to be full of sorrow. Our mindset is governed by an unbelieving spirit that fears and dreads what it cannot see and what it does not know. And that is not who you and I were created to be.
Praise the Lord.
And the very moment that Adam reasoned, he lost that mind of identity. He could not be no more like God than he already was. But the serpent said, in the day you shall eat thereof, you shall be like God. And he bought the lie that he wasn't who God said he was.
Amen.
He bought the lie that he was missing something. He bought the lie that God withheld something from him. And we've been buying that lie and selling it for 6,000 years. Selling it. That a whole man and a righteous man can't be a complete man and a total man. Always has to lack something. Always has to need something. Well, glory. I got your attention now. This is the best time to preach when your soul's listening. Amen. Forced to believe that you have to step on whoever if you're going to succeed. And there's no way to come up just simply because of the goodness of God. And so in buying that lie, Adam fell in his identity. And so God said, you can't stay in this garden. It wasn't that he couldn't stay. It was that mindset couldn't stay. You understand that? And I'll wrap her up right here. That's what couldn't remain. The man of God, the woman of God, the redeemed of God. Glory. Not only shall but has tasted of the water of life. Come on now.
Thank you, Jesus.
Drinking from the right river. That's the reason some men use kicking to get out right now. It's because you know you can do it if you just get the right mindset working. You know you can do it. It wasn't you that thought up better things, desired greater means. That wasn't you. That's God in you. God is birthing a desire in you for something greater and for something better. Now let me tell you something. God, watch how this happened. In the turn of the century, the 1900s, God on the East Coast sent A.J. Thomason to birth Pentecost in the mountains of North Carolina. At the same time, God put Charles Parham in Topeka, Kansas, in the Midwest. Hallelujah. They came in this country, they came into those lands, God told them to go there. They went to Texas, didn't have a dime of money. They lived off raw turnips they found in a field. Until they could get enough money to go to Kansas. When they got to Kansas, they bought a mansion that everybody had neglected because they thought it was haunted from the guy that lived there before nobody'd even go in the door, and he turned it into a Bible school. Bunch of the students, they had a prayer room on the roof. They called it the upper room. But they didn't believe in the Holy Ghost, didn't believe tongues was for today. bunch of the students got to read Acts 2 and asked Brother Parham, said, is this for us today? Brother Parham said, I don't believe it is, but don't take my word for it. Get on the rooftop and pray and ask the Lord. Well, they got on the rooftop and prayed and asked the Lord, and he baptized all of them in the Holy Ghost and speaking in tongues. Brother Parham never could understand why he couldn't get the experience, and he was standing up teaching the Bible class one night, and while teaching, his tongue began to get thick, and he couldn't say what he wanted to say, and he asked that class that he was teaching, would you please pray for me? I believe I'm having a stroke. My tongue is getting thick in my mouth. Only to give way to the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. He got baptized in the Holy Ghost. He taught the Holy Ghost. Outside of his class in the days of segregation in 1906, William Seymour, who was a black brother blind in one eye, sat outside of that door because he was not allowed to come into that service, but caught the fire, went to Azusa Street in Los Angeles, California, rented a horse livery stable, cleaned it out, and begun the Azusa Street revival that swept the whole nation. God was doing awesome things, wonderful things, mighty things, powerful things. Nobody, there were no denominations. There were no separation. Glory be to God. Ooh, there was no your church, my church, our way, your way. It was just a move of God. Hallelujah. Ooh, glory to God. I feel that all over me right now. That's what God's getting us back to. A place of no barriers, no boundaries, no borders. No Baptist doctrine, Methodist doctrine, or even Pentecostal doctrine for that matter. Just the divine expression of the Holy Ghost. Amen. When all was said and done, the brethren formed their own little league and they denominationalized it. Broke it up. Broke it up. Are you listening? Then God finally raised up a bunch of men in 1948. By the time 1948 had got here, from 1906 to 1948, there was no prophecy left in the church. There was no laying on of hands for the gifts. There was no falling out in the Spirit, no dancing in the Holy Ghost, and no miraculous moves of the Spirit as far as physical healing was concerned. Nobody believed in nothing anymore. And in 1948, a league of preachers, most of whom were from Ottawa, Canada, met at a conference together around a table. Hallelujah. He may be your favorite. But Clarence Larkin published in his book and said outright that tongues falling out, shouting, I've got one in my library, I've highlighted where he said it. Shouting, prophecy, gifts of the Spirit, and people running all over the church laying on their hands was nothing more than demonic manifestations. Yet the church world for years taught Bible study courses. I'm not talking about fundamentalists. I'm talking about the Pentecostal church taught out of Clarence Larkin's big green book, Dispensational Truths. I got one over in my study right now for the purpose of once in a while, if somebody gets too bad stirred up, I try to say it ain't my word, it's his word. And look, I didn't say it, he said it. Glory to God. And these men said, these men who they're teaching us from do not believe in tongues, do not believe in the gifts of the Spirit, do not believe in the Holy Ghost. No wonder our churches are dead and dried up. We will break from this and go. And they went on a fast and sought God to reveal to them what to do. And the move of God was born. It was called the Latter Rain Revival. In the Latter Rain Revival, something new started happening. God started spontaneously giving them songs and courses. They published books that big of brand new. Every time revival comes, there's a new song born. Hallelujah. They published, what are you talking? I'm talking about God's been trying to holler at man for all this time. Said, wake up! I've already done it. You've just got to get on over here where it's happening. Hallelujah. And the, oh God, those men, they formed, I'm telling you, they had a divine. The prophecy came back to the church. Laying on the hands came back to the church. Gifts of the Spirit started happening in the church. A move of God was on. Amen. And in 1950, 51, and 49, even at some points it was some different ministers. God birthed the Voice of Healing Revival. God raised up Branham and Cole and Allen and Brother Roberts, hallelujah, and Gordon Lindsay and Kenny Pagan and F.F. Bosworth, oh, Lord Raymond T. Ritchie. These men were small statured, some of them, especially Brother Ritchie was a very short, skinny man, but they were full of dynamite. They could run any disease out of that room that dared to show its face. Why? Because God was revealing to man that he didn't have to stay under any kind of bondage anymore, but he had been liberated. Yes. Not just saved in spirit, redeemed in body and in soul and in mind, hallelujah, totally delivered. Oh, I got the clothes. Lord, they didn't know, I'm telling you, but you know what else happened? Some of them preachers that could pull a gourd out of the throat didn't have an ounce of preaching ability. They'd say some of the dumbest things in the pulpit you ever heard in your life. So God went through another period. And oh, hallelujah. He had awakened the gifts, now he awoke a new word. It was called, hallelujah. Well, first of all, let me say that gave way to the charismatic move in which the Lord instituted tongues back into the tongues and prophecy. Catholic nuns in their habits were seen on Catherine Kuhlman's platform, laid out by the hundreds, baptized in the Holy Ghost and speaking in other tongues. Priests with backwards collars would fall over on their backs and speak in an unknown language. Woo, hallelujah! Women started coming to the forefront. My God, they said Mrs. Kuhlman had such an anointing when it would get strong on her. Her feet would come up and she just glided across the flat platform in the glory. Hallelujah. She moved differently. She didn't use prayer cards or healing cards. She called out the disease by the word of knowledge, and she didn't lay hands on them for healing, but they were healed by the spoken word as they set out in the crowd. That went on right up through the 70s, and in the mid-70s, somewhere along the time that I was conceived, God raised up a new wave again. This time it was a word wave. It was called the Word of Faith Movement. Hallelujah. Kenny Pagan seen that God was going to shift from the voice of healing to the teaching of the Word of Faith to impart to people how to get their own deliverance. And he raised up a nation under his name of preachers who taught people that sickness was not from God and disease didn't come from heaven and poverty was not of redemption, it was of the curse. Hallelujah. They taught. My God. Then in the 80s, the church underwent a purging, a deep purging. They found out quickly. God showed them that if you may not agree with this, but it don't matter now, I'm through. Now if that's in the first of the message, I'll wait till the end to get it, because I need you, amen, amen. But what I want to say to you was, if you could see this like I see it, God showed this world that if a man falls, he shall rise again. In that whole period of the 80s, men of high stature, on high places, and the world watched what they thought crumble. And them same men that they thought was dead and crumbled. Hello. They're in full swing right now. He had to show the church how you deal with things. That you don't cast out your own. And you don't spit on people who are men and women of God just because something didn't go the way you thought it ought to go. But if you see your brother overtaken in a fault, restore such a one to the faith, lest you yourself fall away. Amen. Is that the word? Oh, yes. Then in the 90s, God put joy. Oh, my God. Hallelujah. I just wish you could know What a deliverance Sister Janet got when God brought Joy Revival in the 90s. Mm-hmm. I was in that service. Sister Shirley, we were sitting right, and you was up in the front there about it. Amen. I was further back, and I'm telling you, that church seat, 10,000 people, you could just sit and talk or nothing and hear what somebody was saying it should be, but you could hear Janet all over that whole room when God broke that thing in her. Right, joy come out of her. She laughed from the bottom of her spirit for hours and hours, and I want you to know she never did have another battle with that depression again. The Lord, not. Thank God for the joy. Thank God for the joy. But then, here's what I'm trying to show you. Every one of them had their downplay. They fizzed. And somebody said, why would God let it be? Don't you know by now? Because it was giving way for something greater. Now, we're standing in that day right now. You do believe in full restoration, don't you? You believe in the restoration message that God will restore the years that the cankerworm of the world. Well, I can tell you right now, you better identify with where we're at now in the spirit. Because there's some people still identify with Brown's Day. They go to his grave every year. In fact, they'll do it next Sunday, Easter. That's right. And they'll go set vigil in his headstone, worshiping the man.
That this final move is a bride move.
And the way you know that you're in the bride is because you're being allowed to hear the things you're hearing. Because that's who the bride is, the one that has ears to hear what the Spirit says. You also better realize that it takes 6 months teaching just to clarify one of these messages on this stuff, because one of the most powerful rounds you'll ever get a hold of is knowing what the bride really is and her position for this end time glory manifestation. But I would encourage you to block out anybody that says it's over. Block that out, because it ain't even begun yet. And I would also say to you that you've been on this. It's fitting we sang Holy Ground, because you've been on holy ground in the Spirit this morning. The Lord's given you a word He just can't give to everybody, because everybody don't believe in an end time restoration. I know. Listen to them. They're running scared right now. That's the truth. Running scared. I got news for you, friend. This revival, this move of God, whatever you want to call it, this glory manifestation ain't going to be hindered or helped by who gets voted in or not, by who runs Washington or not. I tell you, it's a New Jerusalem revival. It's a bride of God. Hallelujah. He's getting ready to consummate something with His bride in this earth. Sarabaroto. Eshananaya. Don't you know your Bibles? There's a man-child got to be born. I said, there's a man-child got to be born. You ever read Revelation 12? There's something coming forth that ain't going to come out like a little baby that ain't got no power. It's going to come forth full grown. And in full Ulamashiach, every other revival, they've been able to harvest because it didn't have time to grow to manhood. But this thing that God's getting ready to do, it's going to come in the form of an infant. And it's going to come in the form of a crying baby. But it's going to come in the form of a full-grown son. Oh, Shabbataya. Amen. And I think the Lord would also have you know that every minister I just spoke of during their time prophesied of this day. Jack Cole said the Lord told him there would come an hour when the Lord would fully heal the whole body of Christ, and there'd not be one sickness among us, and they crucified Him without shame for saying such a statement, because in them days the church believed God used sickness to teach you His will. Now we've come a long way. Anybody tells you that now, you'll say, liar, liar, I know better than that, amen. And the church used to teach it that Satan was the left hand of God. Amen. And that He needed Him to use Him to accomplish evil that He couldn't do Himself. We hear that now, we say, liar, liar. They said poverty was a tool to keep humility in your heart. Boy, they say that now, I'm going to say it 3 times. Liar, liar, liar. Amen. Hallelujah. Brother Branham said there'd be a people come up that would have all power in their hand. He said that if they even got in the presence of a disease, it would flee the midst because of the presence of that one. And then Brother Branham in a car wreck died, and his dear wife already was dead. And Billy Paul come to the door and said, Dad, what do you want me to do? They didn't know what to do. Brother Branham had more power than anybody around him. They didn't cross him or ask him nothing. They just obeyed him. He had a realm like no man ever walked in. That's the truth. The power of God moved on his hands so strong he couldn't wear a watch, because if somebody with cancer come in front of him, and that power would move through him to cast that cancer out, and it would absolutely destroy everything in that watch. Every bit of movement would be stopped. They couldn't fix him. That's how much power went through him. But Brother Branham said, Billy, how's Mom? He said, Dad, Mom's gone. He said, she ain't gone, Billy. Put Dad's hand over there on her. He said, Dad, close to dying, he couldn't even lift his own hand. And Billy Paul put his hand on his mother, Brother Branham's hand on her, and she rose from the dead in that car. And you won't explain this one. Brother Branham died while his hand was still on her. Raised him from the dead, even in death. Kind of like the old prophet's bones raised him up. Somebody said, well, I don't understand why he left, because he fulfilled his time. And besides that, you say he left, well, where did he go? All he did was step over into the other side. Hallelujah. I feel the lightning of heaven right now. We are so worried. We put so much distance between all of us. No wonder we can't lay hold of it. But the Bible said, I've compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses this morning. Woo, who's in that cloud? Oh, every saint that's gone on, every prophet, every preacher, every evangelist. What are they saying? They're telling you, press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Now, Lord, I take every soul into this place that's sat here and heard this day. Lord, we're chosen people. We couldn't hear these things if we would. Ooh, I feel a heavy anointing. We couldn't hear these things if we weren't chosen to hear them. We couldn't know them if we weren't ordained to know them. Lord, we know that because there's millions of people that have the Holy Ghost that still ain't heard them and still don't know them because they've not been brought into the teaching of it. But surely, God, you won't leave them in the dark. Surely, you're raising up an army. Surely, every prophecy has to be fulfilled. And every promise has to come to pass. For there, yea and amen. And to the glory of God the Father. And Lord, I know things look a little small and slim now. But I know you're fixing sin to stampede through the body of Christ. And I know that things are about to get bigger and better. And they're going to kind of get out of hand, so to speak. But God, if the Holy Ghost is doing it, we'll yield our lot to the Holy Ghost. We'll yield our services. We'll yield our ministries. We'll yield our hands. We'll yield everything we got to the move of the Holy Ghost. We'll pay any price. We'll give up time that we don't think we have. We'll even let you have everything that makes us busy, Lord, if it'll let us get busy in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And doing the things of God. I'll miss sleep if I have to. I'll travel when I'm worn out just to be a part of the just to be a part of the glory of the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. My God, don't put me on no perch. Let me rest. Stir me up. Woo, like I've never been stirred before. Wake something up in me that I hadn't felt in a lifetime. Consume me with it. Woo, let the zeal of thy house eat me up, I pray, in the name of the Lord. Oh, God, I don't want to miss nothing you're doing. Oh, Father, I don't want to miss anything. I want to be in the middle. I want to be on the cutting edge. Some people won't make that prayer because they're afraid of that commitment. Because the truth is, it may mean in the long run, you don't get to do everything you want to do. But you get so hungry for them down here, all that stuff seems so trite and small. So you wouldn't care if the Lord picked you up tomorrow, threw you halfway around the world, and made the glory of God just turn your life upside down. Ooh, I don't want it. If it's man, it won't work. But if it's God, I'm open. I'm open, I'm open. Everybody tell the Holy Spirit you're open this morning. I'm open. I'm open, I'm open. I'll tell you how to talk to him. You tell him yes before he ever asks a question. You tell him yes before he gives you all the details. would say, you have not prayed this prayer this day, but yea, I have prayed it through thee. Ye have not been the only one that have heard these words today, but yea, the Spirit within thee have heard them. Yea, ye yourselves in your own natural way have not been stirred only, but something within thee hath been stirred this day, saith the Lord. For I have put my great oil in your pot, and I have stirred up new fragrances, new seasoning, new ballings, new feelings of zeal and passion and fire. And I awaken within thee today the very desire of mine own nature, saith the Lord. And yea, saith the Lord, you won't war back and forth no more over little foolish things. For foolishness doth abound in the heart of a child. But yea, the rod of correction will drive them out, saith the Lord. And is not my word a rod and a hammer? And have not I called thy attention to this great day which thou art living in, saith the Lord? And you shall no longer do a bunch of going in and out, but you're going to come in, and you're going to stay in a while, and I'm going to pour you full, and I'm going to anoint your head with oil until your cup runneth over, says the Lord. And the blessings you shall know in me shall not be little blessings that end in a day or a season, but they shall be eternally effective upon thy life, says the Lord. Yea, saith God, it won't be one service up and another down, one day happy and another in defeat, but I'm changing the whole course of thy past, saith God, and you shall no longer have sporadic moments, but you shall have eternal moments, saith God. And I'm doing something in them need that hath a lasting effect, says the Lord. And yea, you shall know what it is to go in my full house and sit at my table and drink my wine and eat my bread and feast on my goodness, says the Lord. And your belly shall not want any other food, says the Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, glory. Woo, Shabbatate, Hilabaka, son of Maniah. Glory. Glory. Shabbatate. Amen, amen, amen. Woo, she said. She said, I know you don't give it to dogs, but even the dogs eat the crumbs. You know what she tell him? Said, that bunch you feed now ain't going to eat it no way. Said, when you give it to my bunch, we're going to take the whole loaf. Hallelujah. So you might as well give me some of it now, because when you offer it to my generation, we're going to take it. Hallelujah. Oh my God. Well, I'll tell you one thing. You've been Holy Ghost stirred today. Because I didn't need nothing I had planned. That's all from the Holy Ghost. Now, granted, the Lord linked it together. So I can flow right on in tonight should he allow it. But I'm just showing you. There's some words I think we're ready for. And then he interrupts me and gets us a little more ready. Hallelujah. Tells us a little more thing. Michael was talking last Sunday about the Lord speaking that scripture to him, and he thought he wanted him to preach on it. But when he got up and said it, all he wanted him to do was declare it and let it happen. Hallelujah. And he said, after he said it, got ready to preach, the Lord told him, go sit down. Just watch it happen. Sometimes we over-explain. Brother Julian told me this on the phone last week. He said, Matt, I've learned, oh God, he's been in ministry over all his life. He's raised in his daddy's revivals. He said, Matt, I've learned in all these 70-something years, I've convinced myself of one thing. One of the weaknesses we have is overcompensating, pleasing people, explaining ourselves, trying to make one person happy. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Brother, sister, there ain't no time to explain. But you don't have to explain. If you catch the wave, it'll all happen. Sister Heffernan said they went into this house over there in Ireland somewhere, and it was a noted house, and it was, you know, old house, and they were touring it and whatever, and the guy was the Lord in it. And so Sister Heffernan started talking to him, and he just said, well, what about this Holy Spirit stuff? She said, oh, I'll lay hands on you in 5 minutes. You'll be talking in tongues. I said, would you like that? He said, I got a chapel down the hall right here. She said, could we go there? She said, sure. They went in. I know some Pentecostal people wouldn't have went in that chapel. That's the truth. They said, bless God, I'm not going in there. They don't believe, well, so what? Everywhere I go, there's something I don't believe, but I don't make no headway over it. I just shout right on with them, glory to God, and get in with it. But don't you? And anyway, she said, I knelt right down there beside of him. Said he started praying the loveliest little prayer, knelt on the cushion altar. She said, all of a sudden, his English prayer just turned into the tongues. So when she was leaving, he said, please do sign the guest log. And she was signing. He said, can I do that again? She said, sure, we'll do it right now. So they all just raised their hands right there. And that old Irish Lord, probably worth $2 or $3 billion, standing there with his hands raised up, speaking in an unknown tongue. As far as we know, hadn't even went through the sinner's prayer. You better just let God be God, have you? Oh, I got to hurry now. I don't like it. Oh, my God. It's 1 o'clock. God bless you in the name of the Lord. We'll be back here tonight. I'll do my best to cut her short tonight since I run along this morning. Amen.